Welcome everyone for our latest edition of APi Connect, where our brothers, undergraduate and alumni can come together to hear from amazing fellow brothers about life and business and all sorts of experiences. So we're excited to have our brothers join us to hear from and learn today with our APi fellow fraternity brother, Howard Dvorkin, alumnus from American University and CEO of Get.com. I have the personal pleasure of knowing Howard for several years and counting him among my APi compadres. My name is Jay Feldman, and I'm the managing director of the APi Foundation. And we're excited to get started tonight. Howard, thank you for joining us from sunny South Florida.
Thank you so much. Actually, I'm in South Carolina today, but sunny South Florida, it's a little bit crazy down there, and I just needed to take a mental break, so I have a little horse ranch up here, so a Jewish guy with a horse ranch, that's a whole nother story, but I appreciate having the opportunity to speak to you and the brothers and frankly tell you what we do, and hopefully we can help a lot of people, and even more so than the people just watching this video. Hopefully other people have the opportunity to learn something.
Excellent, excellent. Well, especially in times like what we're dealing with right now with the COVID-19 and financial volatility, stuff taking place. A lot of people are trying to figure out what's next. And it's also an opportunity for people to reflect and do some housekeeping. And so, which is why we thought that the subject of today might be a really great topic to share with our brothers, and to have an expert in one of our brothers like you to share that with us, we're tremendously grateful. So before we really dig into the subject matter, we often like to ask our guests tell us a little bit about where they're from and their APi experience as an undergraduate. So if you could share a little bit about that, please.
Terrific. Essentially, grew up in New Jersey. I say the swamps of New Jersey. Went to an American University, graduated in 86, Sigma Pi chapter. We recolonized that, went from about 5 guys to 80 guys in about a year, and we were the best fraternity on campus overnight, and it was a great experience. Allowed me to do a lot of, develop my skills as a leader, and one spring break, went down to South Florida, and I for spring break when Fort Lauderdale was a blast, and I never came back. I just stayed there for the most part. Went to University of Miami for grad school, met another AAPI guy, and developed a life, and it was a great experience, and I've been trying to stay in touch with AAPI and develop young men into great leaders and great people. And certainly during this time of uncertainty, I'm happy to help out any way I can. I will tell you, I got my little COVID hat here, so some self-promotion, my debt.com hat, but also more importantly, my son, he gave me some letters because I gave him, he just was initiated at Syracuse University. So I gave him all my stuff, my vintage stuff that unfortunately probably doesn't fit as well as it did. And he just decided to bless me with this for this video. So typically I dress up a little better, but you know what? This is a relaxed environment.
Absolutely. Great. One of the things that I've always really admired when I come to you in your office down in South Florida is that so much of the leadership at your company are other AAPI brothers, other executives, other business associates of yours. It's always been very impressive to me, left an impression on the value of the AAPI brother relationship. What is it to you that attracts you to want to work with and hire brothers in your company?
Well, we love hiring apes. We love working together. I mean, frankly, it's a family environment. you know, debt.com is not our only business. We actually currently operate 9 companies with about 700 people between them. Debt.com and Consolidated Credit are one of the bigger ones. Consolidated, I founded, and then another brother, Gary Herman, is the president of Consolidated Credit, and I came over to debt.com to kind of lead the charge. But getting back to your question, I mean, when you meet an Ape High brother, you know what you're getting. You kind of have similar experiences, and you know you're getting a smart guy, a hardworking guy, a guy that can work in teams. We love hiring younger guys, and to be very candid with you, if you're an Ape High guy, unless you're a mass murderer or something, you're coming aboard with us. So I open that opportunity because right now debt.com and our family of companies has 40 positions open right now. So spread the word. We're expecting to help a lot of people, but more importantly, we want to train our own and give those breaks to people that, frankly, that to return the favor, to pay it forward. Somebody gave me a break, actually. I was on the phone with my mentor yesterday. He's 88 years old, living in Washington, and still kicking, and he's a fine gentleman, and I would love to do the same for other AEPI guys, and I just enjoy it.
Amazing. We love it. Thank you. And for those of you who are watching, we'll be proud to know that AAPI has also launched our Center for Career and Professional Development. We link undergraduate and young alumni with our esteemed brothers like Howard to help provide career guidance and mentorship. And sometimes those things turn into internship and job opportunities. So it's all about the relationships that we have with our brothers in the fraternity. So Howard, when we think of the word debt, you know, we think of the federal debt, we think of student debt. What types of debt on a personal basis are important to take note of for people to be aware of? And what are the best practices and resources that are out there to manage one's debt?
I mean, essentially, it all starts with what you make. I mean, different levels of debt can be overpowering to anybody. You know, $10,000 worth of debt could be just as crippling as $100,000 worth of debt, depending on your income level and your mindset. Frankly, you know, I like to advise people, live off what you can. Unfortunately, it's expensive, you know, to live off what you make a lot of the times. And so people use the credit cards to subsidize their lifestyle, including, you know, going through and leasing a car and buying a house you can't afford. Just, you got to be smart, but you got to figure out and set up a budget, a physical budget. And we do this for free for lots of people that call in. We get probably 10,000 calls a day, or 10,000 people hitting our websites on a daily basis. And we try to help everybody, and there's no charge for it. We want to help as many people as we can rid themselves of the bounds of debt. And I mean, debt is a horrible thing to have around your neck. And certainly when you're first coming out of college, to be saddled with it, because you're getting hit with, you know, you may come out with credit card debt. You may come out with car, you may buy a car, you have auto debt, you have student loan debt. I mean, that's a lot of money that you owe already, and you don't even have a job. And the fact of the matter is, people need to go through and live off of what they can. And frankly, if the money's not in your pocket, don't buy it. I will tell you, I started my businesses from my kitchen table, to be frank with you. I started with a loan of $7,000 from the bank, and I was so disgusted that I even had to take a loan out that I paid it off in 3 months. and I never looked back. I will tell you that a lot of things, when we started, and I have started many, many businesses over the years, and we all started with our own money, and there's nothing better than putting your money down and being responsible if you win or lose. And sometimes it doesn't feel so good to lose. But at the end of the day, stop buying stuff. I mean, live off what you make. Do you need to drive that fancy car right out of school? Or do you need, does your kid need to have a brand new car? The answer is no. Buy him a used car. Buy him a bicycle. Actually, make him buy his own bicycle. I mean, it depends on who you're talking to. But at the end of the day, you know, debt is the greatest non-discriminator of all time. I mean, you know, it doesn't care if you're blue, green, purple, tall, skinny, fat. It's going to attach to you, and it ain't going away unless you do something drastic to make it go away. And it all starts with your budget.
Right. You know, I remember when I went to school in my AAPI chapter, and then afterward when I was a chapter advisor for the fraternity, you know, you certainly have young people who come to school who don't have their own checking account. They just have a credit card on their mother or father's account. So they're not really aware of how that works or how that accrues because somebody else is paying the bill. But then you also have people maybe where they're paying their own way through school and they're trying to make things work. And that very first week of first school, they see at the campus bookstore, the credit card company offering that free t-shirt with the campus logo or that beach towel logo. And all of a sudden they're like, wow, I can get some freedom and relief because I have access to this. So this is the first generation, you know, where the children who are going to the workforce will be start out making less money than their parents did, the first generation. And will not have the same sort of financial opportunities that their parents' generation before had. So what does somebody do when they're trying to really navigate this?
I mean, the problem, you're right. You hit an interesting point. You know, our parents' belief is our children should live a better life than we did. The fact of the matter is that's almost impossible. We have so much more to spend our money on, so many more distractions. You know, when I was growing up, I grew up in a family with a depression error mentality towards money because we didn't have any. And, you know, it's interesting that when my parents grew up, my parents, yeah, we weren't rich, but we weren't poor. We were middle class. And then all of a sudden my father died and we didn't have any money. I mean, I remember being 13, 14 years old and having the heat turned off in the middle of February. So that kind of wakes you up to a reality. Right. And at the end of the day, you know, you just got to be smart, but you also got to teach your kids to be smart, because at the end, we're all working towards the kids, whether it's you or your kids. There's no good thing about debt. I mean, sometimes there's good debt, like a car or a house. A house is good debt, meaning you're going to spend some money
on that a little bit more. Good debt versus bad debt.
Absolutely. Good debt is something where you buy a house. You're going to pay some interest and you're going to make your payments, but at least you have an appreciating asset. Bad debt is your credit card. You know, you're not showing anything. You're going out to a meal for sushi or what, you're going out, you're getting table service, whatever the case may be, you're slapping down your credit card. And guess what? You spend $200-$300 and you're just letting it roll onto your credit card and you're paying 28% on that. There's no value there, man. So that's bad debt. That's bad stuff. You're not getting any bang for your buck there. Cars is good debt. Car, why is it good debt? Yes, it's a depreciating asset, but it gets you from point A to point B so you can earn money and create a lifestyle for yourself and your family. But at the end of the day, people need to budget and make sure that they're living the lifestyle that they can afford. A lot of people in this country, and certainly during these rough times can afford what they're spending money on. Some don't even have jobs right now, and it's very difficult. Some are collecting unemployment. Unfortunately, some are getting more unemployment now. They're making more now being unemployed than they were before they were unemployed working. So that's a whole different story. But at the end of the day, I think there's going to be some rough roads ahead for a lot of Americans in the next couple of years. And debt.com, I expect, will be there. I will tell you, we have been doing this. I personally have been in the subprime debt world for 27 years. I've seen the movie before. During the last recession, I will tell you, we couldn't answer the phone fast enough. There was so much hurt in the world. We expect that to happen once the federal funds dry up and people start to try to get back to work. And there may not be a lot of jobs like that. There's a cosmic shift that took place. Because you talk to kids coming out of school, they said, I'm going to get $60,000 coming out of school. Guess what? They're not getting $60,000 now. They're not even getting a job. They're not, that same kid that was thinking he's getting 60, he's now getting 30. And he's going to have to work his tush off to get that 30. At the end of the day, if depending on who the crowd is, you need to spend what you make. You need to watch every dime. And don't be stupid with your money. Don't be stupid with your money. And understand that although you think things are going to be better tomorrow, as human beings, we're optimistic. Things are going to always get better. But chances are, tomorrow's not going to be any different than today. So your financial position in life is probably going to be pretty similar unless something really tremendous, substantial happens, right. Which does happen. I mean, it happened to me, to be frank with you.
Right. I want to remind everybody who's tuning in with us that you can submit questions by using the Q&A and chat buttons at the bottom of your screen. And in a short little bit, we'll move to Q&A portion where we'll hear some of those questions from Howard. Mark, if you could, let's talk a little bit about the evolution of your company, Debt.com. I know it's kind of your newest venture, and the thing that it really started out with was consolidated credit counseling. What was the difference? Why did you start Debt.com? And what was the evolution of the business model?
Well, I started out as an accountant, a CPA, in public accounting, working for a firm called Laventhal & Horvath, and then turned into Arthur Anderson. I was doing a lot of restructuring. This is back in the late 80s. And frankly, I sucked as an employee. I was terrible. I would fire myself. I would never hire me. But the reality was, because I always knew I wanted to run my own business, not because I couldn't do the work. And obviously, working for those firms, I got to see a lot of incredible things. I worked with Carl Icahn. I worked with some incredible people that I learned a lot from. So I got to see a variety of businesses. And one of those businesses, was helping people out of corporate debt. And I ended up buying a house. I got married, bought a house, and quit my job all within the first 3 months, within a 3-month period. And I sat down at my kitchen table, as I said earlier, and said, what the hell did I just do? I gave up a nice job, a nice career, and to make no money. And my mother thought I was crazy, and so did everybody else. And I did the research. I sat there for 6 months before, did the research, and there was a lot of people in credit card debt. And this is right when credit cards started becoming very popular, right when you could use them at the gas station, you could use them for groceries, you could use them for all sorts of things at this time. This is 1993.
Before that, there was a limited way to use credit cards?
Yeah, there was. And gas stations had their own credit cards you could only use to force you to use it. So I recognized and did the did the research and realized that there was a need. There was a need, and there was thousands of people out there that needed service. but nobody was servicing those people. I didn't invent the credit counseling space. I just improvised and improved the credit counseling space and basically turned around. And if at that time, if you were in debt, there was a 3-month waiting list to go talk to somebody in and you had to drive to South Miami to go talk to somebody. And that was an incredible problem, because if you have debt, 3 months is a lifetime. So what did I do? I started placing ads in back of the newspapers and magazines, and they would call all over the place, and I would talk to these people and get them, counsel them out of debt. And I was able to go through and help these people get out of debt and grew the business with the help of a lot of people, including Gary Herman, Andy Levy over the years, Evan Lasher, who's a great guy too, he was Marilyn. But a lot of AEPIs have been involved. Howard Rose was another one. He was a CFO at one time. But at the end of the day, people needed guidance. They just didn't know what to do. And there was a massive need. So people said, you can't counsel people over the phone. I said, watch. I said, watch. I can counsel people over the phone. And guess what? I counseled thousands of people over the phone. And then when the internet came, they said, you can't counsel people using the internet. And guess what? We counsel people using the internet. And now the problem was at that time, Consolidated Credit only had one thing. We only could do credit counseling. So only 10% of the people were called us, and there were thousands of people that called us a day. I only could help 10%. So I decided, and with the help of others, and this is a team effort, and I have great people. Every person I surrounded myself with incredibly intelligent people that I've always surrounded myself with. Actually, I'm the dummy of the group. I just have the big mouth. And the rest of them are a lot smarter than me. But more importantly, we turned around. I said, I could only help 10%. I need to help more people than 10%. So we turned around and we started debt.com. And debt.com now, I can help 40% of the people, whether it's credit counseling you need, whether it's debt settlement you need, whether your credit's banged up and you need some help to clean up your credit, whether you have tax debt, whether you need bankruptcy, whether you have mortgage debt. There's a lot of free tools on our websites. And we do a lot of the stuff we do, believe it or not, is for free because we want to help people. And I will tell you that we have probably the best people, not probably, we are the best in the business, world renowned. And I'm not saying that from an ego standpoint. We have operations in the US. We have operations, we have some operations going in Canada with debt.ca. We have in foreign countries. We had offices in England, all over the world. Guess what? Debt is debt. And it doesn't matter where you are, you're going to get hooked on it. And it's tough to get off that treadmill. It's been an incredible career, but the career has allowed me and my team to do really cool things. I mean, we are in high finance businesses. We are in fintech businesses, a lot of computer stuff. We sold one of our computer companies last year to a publicly traded company. We are in many, many businesses, publishing, benefits, aeronautics, tremendous amounts of business. We have 700 people in totality working for us, with us, I should say. And it's great. It's a party. I mean, truthfully, you come into my office and Jay, you've been there. And I might say, you're looking very svelte, my friend. You're looking good, buddy. I like that. But I will tell you that it's kind of a frat party. And that's the way I want. It's a very unorthodox place to work. I call it an entrepreneurial spirit because we are entrepreneurs, but at the end of the day, you could start your own business within our business. And we're going to support you if you have a good idea. And frankly, we have seen people that have grown businesses within our companies and have made millions of dollars as a result of that. And I am thankful that they did that. And I am happy to see people succeed. And really, it comes down to just hard work. And people from all over the place, I get calls all over the place that about debt. I just did something in Mexico recently, and it's interesting. It's just, you know, debt is all over the place and people need to figure out a way out of it. It's not so hard when you take a step back, but once you're in it, it's kind of hard to see through the forest.
Got it. Okay. So we have a variety of people who are tuning in and who will also watch the recording of this. Now, debt impacts people in different ways. There's obviously personal debt, and then there's those who are in business, and the business has debt. How does debt.com approach the two different types of users, if you will, or consumers, right? The individual versus the business.
That's a great question. First of all, debt.com specifically really works with consumers. Credit cards, student debt, tax debt. We are focused solely on the consumer. There are services out there that focus on tax debt. And frankly, in corporate debt. I focused my career working out corporate debt. But today's corporate debt is a little different than normal. Because what used to be, you know, you have your business and it's loaded up with debt. Well, now the banks got smarter after the last recession and they make you sign personally. And you're personally on the hook. So no matter what, your business can go away, but you're going to file, but you're responsible for that debt. And if you remember, just shortly before this epidemic or pandemic started, you know, everybody was getting a lot of solicitations in their mailboxes when you got home. And it certainly, and personally, you know, you go through and those debt, they're saying, here's $10,000 for your business. Most of those people never even had a business. But it's just another way of a personal debt. Some people say never sign personally. Well, guess what? You don't sign personally, you're not getting debt. And half the time, the documents that these banks make you sign are written in such small type, you don't even know what you're sending. You're signing most of the time, including your credit card statements. You could have a credit card with your business name on it, but guess what? You're personally liable for that credit card. They aren't letting you go. So at the end of the day, you know, you got to be careful. No debt is the best thing, but I am a realist. You have to have a credit card in 2020 to just survive. But you need to make sure when that bill comes in, you need to make sure you pay off those bills. And if you can't, then you should think twice about using that credit card, because things aren't, as I said before, things aren't getting better tomorrow or the next day or next month or the month after that.
Right, right. Now, speaking of the pandemic, and we all know that the CARES Act recently came out, and a lot of the countries around the world are looking at ways to provide economic relief to their citizens. A question that we have from our audience coming in from David Ogman of South Florida. David actually is somebody who we both know in Boca Raton. We'll speak a little bit about David in a little bit, but he asked, Howard, what does the pandemic say about the country that both businesses and individuals have debt and bail out after just 2 to 3 months of the shutdown?
Yeah, and David's a great guy, and we're going to talk about him in a few minutes, and I have hopefully have some good news. But at the end of the day, America is in debt. America needs to get out of debt. Just like an individual, you cannot continue to rack up debt and expect a good outcome. And we have just spent, $3 trillion in taxpayers' dollars to try to make this economy stay on the rails, and our glorious leadership politicians think that throwing another $3 trillion at it is going to help this country. What are you, smoking crack? It's not going to help this country. We are going to become a third world country. Politicians should be ashamed of themselves. I mean, as I said earlier, people are collecting unemployment, making more sitting home right now. And I don't mean to be a bad guy, because I am sympathetic and empathetic to anybody that has lost their job. But at the end of the day, you cannot rely on the government. And don't do it. We have businesses. We've had businesses in England. We've had businesses in Canada. You want socialism? You go get socialism. You spend a year up in Canada. You try to go see a doctor, see how that goes. You go see, try to get a job. You go see how that goes. Or you employ somebody in Canada. It's a tough thing. Socialism doesn't work in this country. It's not going to work. We're capitalists. Capitalism is the best thing ever, because it cuts through the bullshit. And I know there's some liberal people here that may hate when I say this, but at the end of the day, you know, unless this country gets on its own budget, we're not going to have much of a budget, and our kids are going to pay the price, and their kids. And it's a shame, because this is a great country and I love it. But at the end of the day, this country cannot keep dishing out money and expecting something good to happen, other than people scamming us and people going through and taking advantage of the government programs. There's going to be all these government programs. I was just on Fox News, Fox Business News a couple weeks ago. There's going to be a tremendous amount of fraud. Tremendous amount of fraud in this. And the government has no clue what's going to hit them. And you know what? You're going to see a few people go to jail. Of course you are. But it's not going to be anywhere near how much people are going to rip other people off. And that's a shame.
Thank you for that very passionate response. just for everybody out there to know, having spent a lot of time with Howard over the years in his office, he has a wall of photographs of the world leaders he's had the opportunity to spend time with, and also government officials. And I can attest to the fact that he supports both Democratic and Republican congressmen and candidates. Listen, the truth of the matter is,
I don't support dummies. That's what I don't support. And there's a lot of them running our government right now.
Fair enough. So, as a follow-up to that, what are your recommendations for both personal individuals and businesses of how much runway they should have in saving so that they can avoid finding themselves in debt? And what are your suggestions and recommendations for strategies on how to create that saving to do so?
I mean, listen, debt is a terrible thing to have. I mean, certain businesses require debt. You have to have debt to operate, to buy supplies. If you buy a building, certainly your real estate, you got to bring in debt. Most of us do. But the fact of the matter is, again, good debt and bad debt. And bad debt, if you find yourself having to pay double-digit interest rates, you aren't going to go very far. Most businesses don't make a 20% return on equity on their investment. So you got to be careful when somebody's throwing around interest rates. I've seen, you know, a big thing when I started this business was people starting businesses using their credit cards. Well, that doesn't work so well, truthfully, because most businesses don't make 20% to the bottom line. And if you're paying 25%, you don't even have to be a CPA to figure out 25% is higher than 20%. You're losing money every single day. At the end of the day, to answer your question, I'm not quite sure that I can, but the fact of the matter is people need to rely on common sense and they need to take a step back. And do you need the latest and greatest? The iPhone, do I need an 11? No, I don't need an 11. I got a perfectly fine 10 here. Or, you know, do I need to buy a new phone? No, I'm going to use this phone until it stops, which is probably 3 years. The cars I drive, I haven't had a brand new car in probably 15 years. I'm lucky that my wife gets the new car and she has really good taste, and I get her hand-me-downs. And I don't really care about cars. I don't really care about much material items. But I do care about this, my letters here, because I'm very proud of this. My son gave it to me, as I said before, earlier. So that's my prized possession right now. But I will tell you that, you know, a lot of people turn around and they get themselves into trouble and they don't need to. They do it to themselves. People need to just be wise about money. Make sure you don't do stupid investments. Understand that throwing, you know, it comes down to working hard, focusing, and having that passion. I will tell you, passion is everything. Passion and leadership. If you have passion, if you do what you like, you'll be successful. And it doesn't matter if how much money you make, because you know what? If you do what you like and you do what you care about, you're going to do well at it. Be passionate. And that's the problem. We're a lot of drones, you know, depending on your stage in life. I was having a call today with somebody. He has three kids. He's got, you know, three kids in college living in Boca Raton. He's in trouble, and he's making $150,000 a year, maybe $200,000 a year. And he's just not going to make it, not with those expenses. So just live within your means. And you know what? Always, always try to save some money, pay yourself first, put away for the future, and you'll be fine. I mean, it's a scary time right now, Jay.
Do you have any suggestions? You know, you talk about creating a budget, living within your means. Do you have any suggestions on your, when you get your paycheck, recommended percentage that you put away, that you don't touch, in order to create that nest egg for yourself?
Well, you need to create a net, depending on your stage in life, you need to create a nest egg. One is for yourself, so try to maximize your 401 and your retirement accounts, and maximize to the point where if there's matches, make sure you don't leave any money on the table. In my
free
company,
money.
We match 50% of what you put in. And the fact of the matter is people don't put money in. I'm like, listen, I'm giving you, here's $1,000 that you're leaving. Take advantage of me. Use me.
Right.
You know, also put money away for your kids' education, because that comes up really quick. Even if it's $25, $100 a month, because an education isn't getting any cheaper and go through. Certainly when somebody, you get a paycheck, you know, you're all happy. Have part of it go towards your expenses to your checking account so you can live, and part of it maybe sends to a savings account or an investment account, maybe over wherever your investments are. I will tell you, depending on where you are in life, if you're closer to retirement, you know, I have a gentleman that works for me. He's a bookkeeper, not an AEPI, but a good guy, but not an ape. He came to me, he said, you know, my wife and I have worked all our lives. We're turning 60 this year. We want to retire in the next 6-7 years. What do I do? You know, he told me he has a couple hundred thousand between her savings account and her retirement and his retirement. And they had a house, and that's about it. And I said, well, first of all, how many people are living in the house? Just me and her. He says, I said, sell the house, take the money, go buy yourself a nice condo or something a lot smaller, because you don't need all that. And then start living on one of your paychecks. In fact, make sure you take the smaller paycheck and try to live on that. So her paycheck goes to pay the bills. His paycheck goes to right into the bank, into investment vehicles. And hopefully they were smart enough not to put everything in equities, because as we know, the market kind of took a big dump, and I think it's gone back up substantially. But truthfully, I don't trust this market. Something just doesn't make sense to me, to be frank with you.
Yeah.
In fact, another AEPI that works for me, Jeff Racenstein from Michigan, he's a great guy too. He and I sit there and we're just banging our heads against the wall saying, we don't get it. And maybe it's just the old Jewish guy mentality, but when you have 20 or 30% of the population unemployed, you got businesses that aren't even open. Half the restaurants in this country aren't going to open. I will tell you that it would be surprising in the short term that something doesn't happen. In the long run, though, I will say, so Ogman, I hear you, David. He's sending me messages. In the long run, the best place to be is in the equity markets for the long run, but be smart. As you get older, you get more conservative, put more towards fixed income, keep some cash out there. I think there's going to be some advantages to turn around. I am not a stock picker and don't promote to be, or don't even pretend to be one. I'm a debt guy. I know how to get people out of debt. And I will tell you that, you know, have some cash around just for the rainy day. 6 months is the rule of thumb. Maybe now it's maybe have a little more, but try to pay off your debt. Don't carry debt. That's the key. If you carry debt, you're making somebody else rich.
All right, so speaking of paying off debt, we have a question from Graham Wise, young recent graduate from Michigan State who lives in Washington, D.C. now. And his question is this: I have credit cards, student loan, and mortgage debt. Which one should I be prioritizing to pay off?
That's an easy question. I've been to Lansing on a couple times, East Lansing, and my blood flows green when I'm there too. So happy, what are the Spartans, I think?
Spartans.
Yeah, good place. Good people from Michigan. But that's an easy one. Pay off your credit card debt. They're charging you a lot of money. They're charging you the most. Prioritize, regardless of the balance. Pay the highest interest rate card you can. Some people say, oh, I've got a card with $1,000 here that's charging me 15%, and I got a card here with $200 charging me 25%. Guess what? Take out the one that's charging you the highest, and then when that's paid, pay the other one off. Clearly, I mean, paying mortgage debt, pay it off. If you make one extra payment on an annual every year, you take a 30-year mortgage and turn it into a 23-year mortgage. And that's going to save you a whole lot of money in the long run. So make sure you pay as much as you can. And remember, there's these things called taxes. Don't forget about taxes, because taxes eat you up. Taxes are, you know, for some of us and most of us are 25 to 40% of our money. And no reason to give it away. So always think in after-tax dollars. Remember that. Some things are taxable. Some things you could deduct. Not a lot these days because of the new tax act. And some things you can't. But the thing that I suggest is everybody should maximize the retirement plans.
Donna, that's really great. Thank you. That's fantastic advice. We have a question from... Sorry about that, Howard. A little technical flip there. A question from Tyrell Elin. Can we speak to secured credit cards and do them work?
I can. That's an easy one. But first, I want to mention David Ogman's foundation. He has a foundation for his child, and he has a very significant, serious situation. And I know you're going to provide a link in a little bit, and hopefully you're going to provide it well after. Anybody that clicks on that link, does business with us, gives it to a friend, they do business with us, or gives it to their employer for their employees to get help and comes through that link. I was gonna give $250 per enrollment to David's foundation, but he's such a great guy, I'm gonna bump that to $500 for every link, and that's gonna stay on there for the next year. So David, it's up to you. You know, my pleasure to help you out. So let's try to take care of our brother's kids. And I will tell you, so $500, if we get 100 people, that's a lot of money. If we get 1,000 people, I'm going to come work for you, bro.
We'll share that. We'll be sure to share that.
I want you to share that because you know what? David's a great guy and he works tirelessly for this, for AAPI in South Florida. He's a great guy. I've gotten to know him over the years, over the last couple of years. And he's definitely has a significant challenge ahead of him. Unfortunately, I've seen that play out once with my some of my partners with similar situations. And we got to make sure that we take care of our own. What was the secured card? Okay.
Yeah, so by the way, that question came from one of your chapter brothers from fellow Sigma Pi, 1997.
Now, who was it?
Well, 1997, brother Elon.
Ah, that guy. Listen, secure cards. Secure cards are, there's a credit card. You don't put any money down. You don't put any money down. You get to charge up. All of a sudden, you're in debt. Secured card, you have to put, it's like a bank account. They issue you a credit line for the amount you put on. In that bank account, you could charge up to that amount. Obviously, you got to have a lot of cash. Typically, secure cards are good for certain things. People new to the credit world. You have a kid, send him to college with a secure card. He won't get himself in trouble, and more importantly, he won't get you in trouble. But eventually, that secure card, a lot of companies open that up and say you have a $500 limit, you're good for a couple months, and you get to increase that limit without putting extra dollars in. So they get you one way or the other. But at the end of the day, stick with debit cards. You only can charge what you have in the bank. Secure cards are a great product for the right situation. And they're not every secure card is built the same. And you sometimes have to watch out for the landmines in secure cards because they are for people typically with no credit or bad credit.
Got it. We have a question that's coming from a brother named Scott. He's about to send his first kid off to college, just much like you have, sending your kids off to college this past year. And he wants to know, what advice should he be giving to help his son be doing to build credit?
Oh, the first advice, the same advice I gave my son, Scotty, become an AAPI brother. That's the first advice. But the second, the real advice is set him up with a bank account. Set him up with a bank account. Make sure he understands how to write a check. Make sure he understands a credit card. When the credit card comes in, let him write the check to pay the credit card. Turn around, show him how to do a reconciliation of a bank statement. You know, and it could be very simple, but let him learn slowly, learn control. Don't let him fall on his face. But sometimes it's always good to let the kids fall on the face because they know everything, of course. And you pick them up, pat their back off, dust them off, and point them in the right direction. But spend the time now, teach them about credit. And frankly, in this country, I will tell you that, you know, the companies that we run, we have spent, it would not shock me if we spent $25, $30, $40 million over the last 10 years in educating people about credit. There is no credit education in this country. Where are you going to learn it? You're going to learn it in school? No. You're not going to learn it in high school. Are you going to learn it in college? Only if you take a personal financial course, maybe you'll learn it. Are your parents going to teach it to you? Maybe some of our parents, but chances are the parents know less about credit than the kids. Or because, frankly, I wouldn't be in business if they knew about credit. But the fact of the matter is, you know, you need to learn. And be careful what you read on the internet, because half of it is bull. You know, understand that you need to do your own research and understand where you're coming from, and try to teach your kids before they get themselves in trouble. And if they get themselves in trouble, torture them, make them pay that credit card payment, make them earn that money back that they screwed up with. I will tell you that I've counseled a lot of college kids in my days, and a lot of college kids, you know, get heavy into debt, going out, taking their friends, they're a big shot. Dad gave me the credit card. Guess what? They had to drop out of college. I had a college kid, he was a freshman, his second semester, he had $13,000 in credit card debt. I've had kids turn around, and unfortunately, they hung themselves in their dorm rooms because they had credit card debt. I've had adults turn around, call me, I have a gun in my hand. I mean, it is part of my job as a credit counselor is psychological. I need to know how to deal with this. It's not all numbers. You need to understand the psychology of the debtor. And frankly, I think I do that better than most, at least hopefully, considering we've probably helped probably 10 million people over the last close to 30 years.
Got it. Well, Howard, we're getting close to call of time and last call, so to speak. So let's wrap up with something where we'd like you to walk us through where people go to your website using the links that they're going to have to help support David and his son, Jordan, who's actually our youngest AAPI brother, by the way. What is the process? What are the steps? What does it look like? So that people know what to expect. How simple is it?
It's very simple.
And what are they committing themselves to participate in the process?
Great. They're not committing themselves to anything. They're committing themselves to the desire to get out of debt. So if they click the link that you're going to tell them about, it's a special link and it all gets credited. Any business that we get from that, whether it comes directly from somebody watching this video, their friends, or anybody, David Ogman's foundation, Jordan Ogman Foundation, I believe it's called, is going to get $500 for every sign up. I hope to pay $1 million. If that was the case, and I'd be happy to. Basically, you figure out what your problem is. First thing is, what is my problem? Do I have credit card debt? Do I have mortgage debt? Do I have tax debt? If I have credit card debt, I'm gonna go through, I'm gonna click on the link, I'm gonna read about this, I'm gonna put my name in, you're gonna get a call from a certified credit counselor. And they're gonna tell you, you have these five options to get out of debt. You can keep what you're doing, which doesn't seem to be working, and you'll be out of debt in 35 years. Then you can not pay your debt and file bankruptcy, which isn't so good because you're going to destroy your life and probably the life of your family because you're not going to be able to buy a box of Chiclets on credit. Or you can go through and do a debt management plan, which will reduce your interest rates and reduce your payments by 30 to 50% and reduce your interest rates, because 75% of your payment right now, if you're carrying credit card debt, is going towards interest. With our debt management plan, 75% is going towards liquidating your debt, and only 25% is going towards interest, and you're gonna be out of debt in a couple of years. 3 to 4 years is typical, but you can always increase the payments. The next plan is, if that doesn't work or your payment's too high, a debt settlement plan. is an option where you end up paying 40 cents on the dollar, but you're going to do some damage to your credit. And you probably don't want to do that first out, but you really need an honest total solution of somebody telling you, hey man, this is what you got. Here are your options. Pick one. I don't care which one, but pick one. And by the way, you don't have to go to debt.com. You could go anywhere. You could go anywhere. There's some great companies. Make sure if you're going to use debt, a debt guy, make sure they're a national organization. Make sure that they are registered with the BBB. They are licensed. They have certified counselors. They're a member of an association, because there are a lot of bad people in this space, a lot of bad people, and they are looking to take your money, and they will take it. They will separate. I mean, at the end of the day, debt.com goes through and does the work for you. We find the best partners to partner with that are good, credible people with great track records. And by the way, we know who the good guys are, and we're going to send you to the best people.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Howard. This has really been fantastic. Really appreciate it, sharing your insight and your wisdom with us and your knowledge. In a few weeks, you'll be joining us again, specifically for our students, to share some greater insight on student debt and debt that young adults tend to be more accustomed to finding themselves with. So we appreciate you going to be returning.
Only if I can curse. Can I curse? If I can curse, I'm coming. If not, no way.
We got to make sure that we have Scotty coming on with you so that he can sign in as well and vouch for your advice.
For my lunacy.
Great. Well, thank you again, Howard. And to everyone who tuned in with us tonight, thank you so much for joining us. Remember to always check api.org/connect, api connect, or follow us on Facebook to see what upcoming webinars are. Next week, we have fellow api brother, co-founder and CEO of Home Depot, Bernie Marcus, joining us. Hopefully you'll tune in for that. Thank you so much, everyone. And again, Hal, thank you.
Thank you for having me on and the opportunity. Everybody, I just want to wish them stay safe, stay positive. We're going to get through this. And God bless your families, and God bless AD Pie, and God bless America. Be good, guys.
See you soon, Howard.